Thank you so much, John. Thank you, everyone, for your very kind welcome and for your bravery and engagement and the effort of coming out on a dark night to the cathedral and filling it with your warmth as well as your thoughts. And you're welcome. Thank you very much. It's always lovely to come to Exeter. And what a privilege. Actually, I live in York, so I just skip from one lovely cathedral town to another and enjoy the architectural magnificence. And there's no... these cathedrals, these buildings are, of course, in many ways, models of the cosmos themselves. It's the entire universe we sit ourselves in. And so we're in a kind of living stonework memorial of the deep relationship. Perhaps the dance, that was, I think, John's word, not mine, of science and religion. So let's just, let's start. And I wonder, what I should probably do is to declare just a few prejudices for you and things I'm not going to do. So let me just tell you what I'm not going to do. And if you've come here for this, you're perfectly welcome to leave now. I am not going to answer the question, how do you, Professor McLeish, scientist, FR, blah, 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 how do you reconcile your science and your religion? Okay, so half the audience goes up. I'm not going to tackle that question. But one reason is there are many people who have tackled that question, hundreds of people. There are books from here to the ceiling who've tackled that question. In fact, there are very few other questions in the history, recent history, of the church's dialogue in science and religion that are asked and answered. But to me, that question belongs in the same bin, as our bishop so eloquently pointed out, as the question, have you stopped beating your wife yet? Remember that question? Well, yeah, no, yes, I mean, what? No, I don't want to answer that question. The question assumes far too much. You see, I've never had to face that question personally. It never arose. And the fact that it arises is due to, I would say, a century or so of misinformation. But I never thought I would be grateful to President Donald Trump's communications secretary for giving us the new language for this. The conflict narrative now can belong under the heading alternative fact. So I'm going to start somewhere completely different and motivated by a different energy. So I think, you see, that science is in trouble. And I think that our culture is in trouble and it's lost a precious gift by what we have done to science. What we've done to science is to put it in a little box, or rather a laboratory, run by people, actually, frankly, always men, nearly, in white coats, with graying or greyed hair like John or me, and clipboards, yes, or we're caricatured in programs like that wretched Big Bang Theory that makes me laugh and cry at the same time. You know, scientists are weird, and you really wouldn't want a party with them. And science is something that doesn't belong in our cultural contemplation and celebration, as does theatre or art or music or telling stories or playing games with our grandchildren or writing poems. But I believe it does belong in that beautiful casket, or indeed in that drawing room or concert hall. And we've forgotten how to play the music with science. The way I put it is that science desperately needs a new cultural narrative. If you don't believe me, tune into Radio 4's chatter program tomorrow morning, listen to John Timms, whoever it is, hear the way they talk about politics or sociology or international culture, and then right at the end, about 10 to 9, Professor so-and-so will turn up and talk about a new molecule or a distant galaxy, and you can hear the clown bells jangling, can't you? It's not something for us, it's perhaps at best a bit of entertainment, but we wouldn't want to engage with this too seriously. But it wasn't always true. And it's become dangerous because another discourse or type of discourse that I think has become impoverished, as well as our contemplation of the glorious human gift of being able to gaze in to the structure of the atom or the depth of a living cell or into the spiral arms of a distant galaxy and reconstruct in our minds what is going on in that intolerably grand dynamics. There's another sort of narrative which is much closer to home. If I say fracking, or climate change, or nuclear waste, or genetic medicine, those important, highly debatable, vital issues for our future that are based on a knowledge of science, these questions in terms of their ethical understanding cannot be rolled out, cannot be left to the scientific community on its own. We all need to work this through together. What do we do, not only with this extraordinary power we have, but our extraordinary ability to change our world, both for good? Think of the eradication of polio. Wonderful achievement, global achievement. No more suffering. Or think of the threat of climate change or of nuclear Armageddon that still hangs over us. Right? Think of those two different poles of what science can do. How desperately we need a shared cultural contemplation and engagement with science. So this talk is not a nice to turn up and thinky. I'm sure it will be. I hope we'll all enjoy it. But I believe actually it's a matter of the future of the world. It's more than that. So that's not the question. I'm going to help us ask a different question. People will be coming here from many backgrounds. Many of you will be members of this cathedral, will be Christian believers or believers of some other tradition or faith. Some of you will be members of no faith at all. But just for a moment, suspend disbelief and enter with me into another question, which is this. What is science for within the kingdom of God? If science, like art and music and poetry and intelligence and the ability to build buildings like this and build cities and have children and invent language and everything else, if science is one of those gifts we've received that are potentially good, why did God give it to us? What are we supposed to do with it? Oh, gosh, it's the teleological question. It's a question of purpose. Now, if I was helped to see, that's the important question. That is far more important than the non-question of reconciling science and religion, you see, because if one understands science as God's gift, one needs to go much further forward. So by understanding both what the right question is and taking that question within the believing community of the church with all the benefits of theology and tradition and worship and Bible at our fingertips, the church can get off the back foot of apologetics, you see, and defending itself against science as some sort of threat, and realize that science was always within the church. It was a gift of God on the front foot, and start serving community in leadership around it. Perhaps another illustration will help. You see, for years I had to ask myself why there is this issue with theology and science. Why do people think that there's a necessary conflict or divergence? And for about 10 years I thought the problem had to be with the theology. After all, they say, it's old-fashioned, it's hide-bound, it's buried in Middle Ages or worse, it's just not up to it, right? Theology can't cope with science. Oh, then of course I started meeting some theologians and reading some theology and realizing that this is a tradition, an intellectual tradition as sharp and as fresh as tomorrow morning's crocus, is perfectly able to think constructively, ethically, purposefully about just about anything. Ah, it's not the theology. Well, maybe it's the science. I know, it's the scientists. It's the Richard Dawkins of this world. Sorry, the name has to come up once or twice, doesn't it? Bound to be. Who are more than scientists, but engage in scientism. They're the scientists who think that scientific knowledge is the only knowledge. Scientific thinking is the only thinking worth thinking, and so forth. But then it's a tiny minority of scientists who think that. Most of my wonderful colleagues in the scientific professional world are humbled by science. We're breathless every day at what Einstein said was the most inexplicable thing about science. The most inexplicable thing about the world is that it is explicable, that our minds can grasp at what I said a few moments ago, the workings of quantum mechanics of the atom or the cosmology of the furthest galaxies. Why should we be able to do that? It's a humbling issue of wonder. No, it's not the problem. The theology and science problem is not a problem with theology. It's not a problem with science. And then I suddenly realized the problem was the and. Theology and science. That's the word that does all the damage. Of course, it doesn't draw attention to itself. You don't realize as an and does so much damage, do you? Until it snuck its little wormy virus-like way into your mind. Think of how it frames discussions. Perhaps suppose we had a lecture on rich and poor, or black and white, or the other side of the pond, Republican and Democrat, or liberal and conservative. The and paints, as I like to say, the white line across the middle of the tennis court. And as soon as you said theology and science, in the mind of those of us who engage in the debate is a net, and a one side and the other side, and before we know it, the lines of conflict have been set up. I prefer to think about a squash court, actually. So you see what I'm saying? The science, the few things, the canonical science and religion argument is, to my mind, the wrong place to look for the real science and religion nexus. The right place is in the thorny, pressing issues of how we culturally and theologically think about science. We need to think not about theology and science, but a theology of science. Because that's what theology does. Our Christian thinking thinks about things. In fact, it can think about anything. There is nothing not within the kingdom of God. So let's take science inside the kingdom of God, which is, of course, the cosmos anyway, and ask about purpose within a narrative story. And the third thing I want to say we should do is a bit of Bible study. Sorry, now they have locked the doors, it's too late. Have you noticed, by the way, that the whole science religion question, if you like, is not characterized by vast amounts of biblical work, which is a strange thing, because the Bible is our primary source and has been the primary source of the Christian church for 2,000 years. But when it is used, you know which chapter is most commonly talked about. The debates perform a rather mercurially tight orbit around the first chapter of the book of Genesis. Okay. Now, don't get me wrong, Bishop and others, there is nothing wrong with the first chapter of Genesis. It is a wonderful creation story. But just because it's the first page you get to in the Bible doesn't mean it's the most important or relevant source or resource for thinking about the natural world and our relationship to it. In fact, of course, as I'm sure you know, the Bible isn't actually a book as such, it's a library, and it's catalogued like a library. You have narrative creation history at the left-hand side, and then you go on to a bit of poetry and psalms, and then wisdom, and then prophets, and then New Testament gospels. It's arranged, you see, in sections like this. And just because the creation story at the left-hand side of the shelf isn't necessarily the first one. And what one thing I want to do is to suggest that we read the Bible much more extensively and deeply And though Genesis is a story, in fact, there are two creation stories in Genesis told in different ways, they are not by any means the first, almost certainly historically, to be written down, and they don't constitute the most fundamental creative form. No, that is to be found in the wisdom literature, and for my money, for what it's worth, the snowy-capped Himalayan peak of the wisdom literature when it comes to relevant texts for our purpose is the wonderful, enigmatic, fabulous book of Job. And no one is going to escape a little bit of a look with me at the book of Job. For many of you, it will be a puzzling book. Maybe it's a book you've avoided in the past because of its strangeness, but no, we're going to go there. When we do this, I think we can reappraise this whole question of science culturally, as human beings, theologically, and what I want to say is that throughout this series and beyond, both the church needs to and should be able to embrace science with a great big bear hug as God's gift and stop burying it in the ground like the talents that the wicked servant did not invest, but turn that gift 100-fold, 1,000-fold, 10,000-fold. Now, before I go any further, I'd like to just tell you about a project that some colleagues of mine at Durham carried out with some European universities in European-funded project, long might they last, he says, great, hopefully, on just this question of these difficult, rather tight, rather bitter public debates around new science and new technology. This was a study of nanotechnology. I don't know if you remember, nanotechnology made the headlines a few years ago. It's nothing that new about it, but the chemistry of large molecules, clever systems that could be introduced into our tissues or cells, perhaps. Prince Charles weighed into this debate, actually, and declared that these scientists should be immediately stopped from their wicked Frankensteinian purposes, or grey goo would flood out of their laboratories and envelop us all. Didn't think that was one of Prince Charles's most constructive contributions to debate, actually, though I have a big soft spot for him, of course, as we all, I'm sure, do. But you see, there's a bit of fear there, isn't there? Anyway, so some human geographers and social scientists carried out a narrative analysis of the discussions, the debates, the TV debates, the political debates, non-governmental organizations' positions and so forth, and did what social scientists and narrative analysts are so good at doing, is to dig down beneath the superficial words into the motivating forces. Okay, so someone may say it's too risky to do this, but is that really what they think? Is risk their driver, or is it something deeper than that? And what they found is that there were five deeply buried narratives that the philosopher Jean-Pierre Dupuis called narratives of despair, that although they were never allowed to surface, like giant sharks underneath the surface, underneath the water, were causing nonetheless the ripples of debate. And I'll tell you what those stories are. And they come up again and again and again. They are the fable, be careful for what you wish for, the story of the unintended consequence. Second, the myth of Pandora's box. Remember the Greek story? It's the just so story that in Greek mythology of how troubles got into the world. Pandora, daughter of Zeus, and a human opens the chest, the box, the pot that she's been forbidden from opening, and out fly all the troubles in the world. And once they're out, you can't get them back. Third story, mess with nature. Nature is sacred. We should leave sacred nature alone and retire into our human world and leave nature unto. And then there were two more modern languages, the science will keep us in the dark, and the economic Marxist narrative, the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. These were the five stories that were propelling the debate. I want you to notice something about them. They're all negative, they're all despairing, and they're all pagan. There's not one deep narrative around science or technology in our society that is informed by deep Christian thinking, in spite of two millennia or more of reflection on obedience, faith and works, working out our salvation, nothing. The church has been silent. Why has the church been silent? Because the church has insisted in framing science as a threat, not a gift, as something to be defended against, not to cherish and work with, so it has been silenced. So look, we've had two reasons for a new narrative already. We're culturally impoverished because we haven't learnt to contemplate. We've lost the art of contemplating the common human glory of celebrating our ability to recreate nature in our minds. That's a common good. And secondly, the church has abdicated itself from its responsibility to support a positive, healthy, critical, yes, but engaged debate around scientific issues. So where are we going to start? Where are we going to start? Well, there are a few clues of where we might go. When left in this sort of position, you have to dig down to fundamentals. I'm sure many of you work with organizations that from time to time, you reappraise your core values. When you find yourself unable to make a decision, should we adopt this new technology or shot? Should we engage in this new community or not? The church itself, there are issues, of course, that divide us, right? It's sometimes the case that we've lost our core values, because if you're really connected to good core values, they help you make your decisions. Yeah. So the core value for us is the purpose value. What is science for? And I was reading around, sometimes you get clues at you from strange sources, and an author I love very much is George Steiner, extraordinary, intelligent, wonderful, deep man of letters, post-Holocaust atheist Jewish intellectual, of course, very much affected, as anyone would be, by that extraordinary gash across humanity of the mid-20th century. And he writes a very moving book, which I would recommend to anyone here, called Real Presences. Actually, it's extraordinarily influenced by Christian thinking, you know, for an intellectual Jew. I'll leave that standing for you. It's just quite wonderful book. But at one point, he's talking about the purpose of art. Oh, so my eyebrow goes up, you know, because I'm interested in people who think about the purpose of things. He's talking about why we have art. And he says this, I'll read it to you. He says, only art can go some way towards making accessible, towards waking into some measure of communicability, the sheer inhuman otherness of matter. Did you get me? It's a long sentence, isn't it? Only art can go some way towards making accessible, waking into some measure of communicability, the sheer inhuman otherness of matter. It took my breath away, or my reading breath away, or something. I can remember my mind doing a somersault when I read that. Because he says so many things at once. He says, as other 20th century philosophers have done, actually Hannah Arendt says this beautifully in The Human Condition over and again, wonderful 20th century theological and philosophical political mind, talks about the gap between human nature, the way that we feel like fish out of water. We're uncomfortable in time. Time, as C.S. Lewis has often said, either flows too slowly for us or too quickly. We're uncomfortable with the climate. We complain about the weather. We complain about anything to do with the natural world. Why? It's like fish complaining of water. There's something oddly out of joint about the human condition, isn't there? It's a really interesting analogy. Why should that be? At any rate, he then says, well, art's role is to create a bridge of understanding between us and the non-human material world. So that's the problem. But George, Professor Steiner, only art? Only art? Surely, if science does anything, science makes accessible the sheer inhuman otherness of matter. An early English scientist once described science as perception that goes beneath the surface. His eyes do not rest on the surface of material, but with the aid of our minds goes deep into the structure and the colour and the light within materials. And I love that understanding of science that doesn't rest with a superficial understanding of what we perceive, but takes wisdom and knowledge into what we know. So let's follow this, because if we're now going to do some Bible study, it helps us, doesn't it? Because it won't do any good to look up the word science or scientist in a concordance, does it? Because you won't find it in the Bible. But of course, if science is about our relationship with the material world, then that's a lot more helpful. We can ask where our relationship with the material world, the Judeo-Christian tradition, engages. After all, the reason that science or scientist is not found in the Bible is because you wouldn't find the word scientist even in common or indeed any discourse 200 years ago. I wouldn't, John wouldn't, the scientists who are here wouldn't be called scientists 200 years ago. Take me to 1840. Now, who knows what I'd be called in 1840? A natural philosopher. We'd be natural. I envy deeply those very few colleagues of mine who still hold chairs of natural philosophy. My great friend Wilson Poon has one in Edinburgh. And if I hated people for things like that, I would hate him for being a natural philosopher. Because unpack the word science. Now, even if we don't know ancient languages, because of how language works, we are alert to the baggage that words bring to us. And science comes from scio, sciere, Latin. Half of you learnt that at school. I know, it's a knowledge claim. If I'm a scientist, for one thing, I'm coming from the Roman world, left, right, centurion, stand to attention. And for the second thing, I'm making a knowledge claim. If I'm a natural philosopher, philosophia, I'm coming from the Greek world. I'm at least towards the end of the civilization more trampled on than trampling. It wasn't always so. But at least I think. But philosophia, love, wisdom. I love wisdom. So if the word science is an awkward word for you, try replacing it with a love of wisdom to do with natural things. Does that sound more encouraging? Would you like to do an evening course on the love of wisdom to do with natural things? Good, of course you would. Now that, of course, is the clue that also tells us where we need to look in the Bible. Because if science has its roots, and we're following back our roots, often when you want to dig deep down in meaning, it's a good idea to dig deep back in time. Who said that all of philosophy was footnotes to Plato? So we better learn Plato, hadn't we? But Susan Nyman, who is the director of the Berlin Institute, is herself a philosopher in Berlin, wrote an extended web essay in November of last year in which she says that Plato is one of the two pillars on which the whole story of philosophy sits. And the other pillar is the ancient wisdom book of Job. So I don't even have to persuade you, because Professor Susan Nyman says that, who are we to disagree? Within the book of Job, as in throughout the wisdom literature, by the way, and the Psalms, are many of these creation stories. Let me tell you again, in the Old Testament alone, there are at least 25, I gave up count. Creation is told in different ways with different languages, time and time and time again. It's told, by the way, when God's people, Israel, have lost the plot, they think they know they're supposed to go to a place of vindication and peace and fruitfulness, but they're in a place of woe and oppression and darkness. The book of Proverbs, that's why the book of Proverbs has the most beautiful creation story in it, almost the birth of wisdom. Proverbs chapter 8, look it up when you get home. Little girl, wisdom, Sophie, the little girl of wisdom, is God's right hand, rejoicing as mountains are thrown up and seas are divided from the land and the foundations of the earth and the heavens are stretched over the canopy. And that's the fundamental creation story. It involves it's a sort of separation of chaos into ordered parts of the cosmos. You know, it's the creating the pillars of the deep. It's moving the waters away from the land. It's creating the canopy overhead and the foundations underneath. It's a good place to, never mind PowerPoint, cathedrals are much better. That's the ur-creation story, and you find it about 20 or 30 times in the Bible. And Genesis is a version of that on which liturgical week is built and so on, but that's another lecture, isn't it? When we travel to the peak of the wisdom literature, we find ourselves in the book of Job. And the place I want to start there is in our search, is the place that strikes scientists as the most breathtakingly beautiful poem they've ever come across. Now, I'm sure you're all familiar with the structure of the book of Job and know that it's the Bible's version of a common ancient genre. It's the story of the suffering righteous person. Job hasn't done anything wrong, but he's lost his family, his livelihood, his house, his living, and his health. He's suffering there. He's surrounded by three friends who for 3 days do just the right thing and sit there in silence. And on day four, they make a terrible mistake and open their mouths and try and say things, not to comfort him, but to accuse him, because they can't cope with this. And he can't cope with it either. And there are three cycles of speeches in which Job speaks, and Eliphaz speaks, and Zophar speaks, and Job speaks, and then Bildad speaks, and Job speaks. And it goes around three times and gets more, and it escalates in its personal accusatory language. And towards, finally, Job demands to be heard. And God's silent. But eventually, after 37 chapters of this argument and this whirl, Yahweh finally speaks out of the whirlwind. And what follows are four chapters, 166 stanzas of nature poetry, in which each verse has the form of a question. Do you know the way to the abode of light? Do you know where the hail comes from? Have you ever, can you call a day to dawn? Do you know the abode of light? Do you know why the Pleiades are clustered together in the sky, while the stars of Orion are cast asunder? Do you know how the eagle flies to the south? And it's beautiful stuff, but these are real questions. They're real questions about nature that open up whole programs of investigation. And strangely, although at Job's time none of those questions could be answered, we do know the answer to some of them now. It's interesting, isn't it? Now, of course, the reason that scientists are surprised and shocked when I show them this passage and delighted is because in the profession, now here's a secret, a professional secret, and it has to do with this education stuff. You see, we persuade all our wonderful school pupils that to do well at science, what they have to do is to find the right answers. And that has the most terrible consequences. Because some, I know I've asked this question, I love working with sixth formers, for example, do general studies with them, with theology and science, and I do art and science, all sorts of stuff, and I love working with them. And you know when you work with a group of people, and you look at people's eyes, and you know, behind the eyes, you know where the bright, the really razor-sharp minds are, because they're hanging on every word. They look at you critically, and they know you say something which is on a little bit of thin ice, and they see it straight away. And you have to work a bit hard with some of these people at the back. You have to work a bit hard with them. I'm sure not in this audience, you understand. I know that you're hanging on every word, and you're going to come up with some fantastic critical questions at the back. I can see it. But I'm talking about schools, you see. And then after a bit, I ask, well, do you mind me? I'd just like to know who here is doing science and who's not doing science? And among the very bright people, of course, there are several who aren't doing any science. They're doing humanities, they've chosen. And I asked them, do you mind? Because clearly you could have done anything. I can see you could have done any subject you want to at sixth form. Why can you just tell me why you don't? Why you haven't chosen science? 9 times out of 10, it's not because we thought it was too hard. The people at the back are having to work with a bit harder. If you ask them and they haven't, they say because we're not good at it, we're too hard. The bright people who are really critically engaging, they never say that. They say, because we thought there was no room for our imagination or our creativity. It's a terrible thing. It's terrible because every scientist knows that the critical, imaginative, creative step in science is not finding the right answer. It's asking the creative question. Einstein said it. Heisenberg said it. Everybody says that. And I say to them, I'm sure John does too, to a new an aspirant PhD student, new researcher, young person entering our laboratories, day one, welcome, it's wonderful. It's lovely to have you here and congratulations. But you've been here because you've been good for 15 years. You've given the right answers in the book or in the examiner's crib sheet. But I've got some terribly bad news for you. That from this day onwards, that skill is going to be almost entirely useless to you. And what I'm asking you to do is to imagine the creative question, the one that's just within our grasp, that will take our research onwards. So you see, when I say to scientists in the bar after a conference, when we're having a drink and talking about God, as happens at least at half the conferences I go to, before you go to sleep tonight, read Job 28. Now, of course, where are we? We're at a conference, we're at some conference host. It could be in Japan or Europe, somewhere. Thanks to the Gideons, I know that the one ancient document they will have by their bedside contains this text within it. Breakfast time the next morning, they come back delighted, amazed. Questions. Where does this questioning book come from? What is it about the Lord's answer to Job? And why is it so infatuated with the material world? 10 more minutes, John, is that all right? Fantastic. Okay, we're on schedule, that's all right. Because then we'll get there. If we can crack this one, we can crack it. Now, I have to say, the scholarly exegesis or scholarly criticism of the Lord's answer to Job isn't very positive. Okay, so it goes more like this. Job, here you are complaining at me that you're suffering when you shouldn't be. Why me? Why have I lost all this? Why is my flesh rotting on my bones and all this stuff? In fact, you're doing worse than complaining. You're standing up and demanding that in court that I stand here in front of you. Okay, let me ask you a few things. Do you know where the hail comes from? Can you throw the stars in the sky? Do you know how the animals give birth in the wild, in the mountains? No, you don't know much, do you? In fact, you don't know anything, so why don't you shut up? No, and it's said in more scholarly language, but that is the received, that one scholar said, this is not Yahweh, this is a put-down deity, a flippant put-down deity. Well, I wonder, that's the first accusation. The point is, it's just a put-down, right? It's just a put-down, you know nothing. The second accusation is it's irrelevant that the book of Job, the primary, first 37 chapters are about the moral question of unethical suffering, and God answers that. It's supposed to be an answer, but it's a load of dumbfool questions about stars and planets and penguins, and not penguins actually, but hawks and things. So the textual criticism is no, it's nothing to do with the original text. It's tacked on and sewn on. It's a reduction. Well, if we read though. If we read those first 37 chapters, you will find that the subject of our relationship with nature is wound intensively through every argument. In every speech of Job and his friends, the natural world is called to account. It even helps structure the dialogue. So when I told you about these three cycles, the first cycle is dominated by nature language of earth, and rock, and inanimate nature. The second speech cycle is dominated by animate nature, by plants, by milk. Sometimes the negative way, Job says, my flesh is rotting off me like curdled milk. It's about chaotic nature. And the third cycle, when the gloves come off and Job's friends finally leave their hypothetical arguments. Well, hypothetically, Job, if someone were doing something sinful and wrong, then nature might be cruel to them. No names mentioned here, Job, but don't you think it's... The third cycle, the gloves come off. You have sinned, and you need to repent. And at this point, we have the whole of Hebrew cosmology opened to us. It's extraordinary. It's very rare. Does God not in the height of the heavens, does he not look down on the topmost stars, high as they are? Can he see through thick clouds veil him? The clouds veil him, and he cannot see as he goes on his way on the vault of heaven. There you have also the twistedness of the book. When God appears in the Bible, particularly the Old Testament, the theophanies are very often clouded. But the reason God is swathed in clouds for Moses, Ezekiel, and so forth is because it would blind us to look upon the unshielded deity. But in Job, the clouds make God blind. How twisted could that be? But nonetheless, this trumpeting crescendo of the whole cosmology is opened up before our eyes. And the reason for this is that Job's criticism of God is double-fold. He echoes Steiner and Arendt's issue. We are opposed by this frightening, chaotic, material world. Yahweh, you are as out of control of the physical creation as you are of the moral creation. You are as ambivalent and aleatory with law as you are with flood. He points to the wadi, which dries out, you can't grow anything to it. Then when you get a bit of rain, it floods. To the lightning strike, to the chaotic, wild, uncontrolled side of nature. And the accusation is no surprise that morality is crazily out of control. And I am suffering, though I have done nothing wrong, because the lightning strikes in random places, and the earthquake, and it's all chaos. And when the arguments reach their climax, it's as if you can't get any further. The immovable force, irresistible force, has met the immovable object. And what happens there in the text? We haven't got to the Lord's answer quite yet. We go to a very different place. We go down a mine. And when you've read Job 38 tonight, when you've done that, I suggest you read Job 28. Job 28 starts when the argument has got nowhere and says, surely there is a mine for silver and a place where gold is refined. Iron is taken from the rock, from the soil, rock that will be poured out as copper. A foreign race cuts the shafts, forgotten by travellers. They dangle and sway. That earth from which food comes forth is underneath changed by fire. Its rocks are the source of lapis, its flecks of gold. We hey-ho, 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 it's off to work we go, down a mine. We're there, dangling and swaying with the immigrant race. Immigrants always do the dangerous jobs. Was always thus, was then. They have lamps in their hats and they gaze up and they see the earth underneath. We're told not even the falcon or the hawk with their sharp eyes sees that. Not even the lion, proud king of beasts, goes where humans go. For only they see the earth, not on the surface, but in its structure of veined silver and gold and the precious stones. Only they deduce that the fire of ages has transformed the roots of the mountains from beneath. Now, do you remember something else I said about science, looking beneath the surface of the structure of the world and rejoicing in our human ability to see into the way nature works? This is my favourite narrative metaphor for science, this Job 28. It's utterly beautiful, the miner. It's iconic of the human's gift of wisdom. For the way this chapter goes on is rather comical. It then admits to the fact that it's a search for wisdom. Can you find wisdom at the bottom of the sea, at the foot of the mountains? No, we've heard of it, but we're not quite sure where it left. We go to the market. There are six different words for gold. If economic well-being could provide wisdom, then we would surely find it here, but it's nowhere to be found. And at the end of the chapter, we finally find the way to wisdom, because God knows the way to it. And listen to how. For he looked to the ends of the earth and beheld everything under the heavens, so as to assign a weight to the wind and determine the waters by measure. God is looking into his creation, measuring it, seeing with this sort of X-ray perception its inner structure, and by doing so and beholding his creation is showing us the way to wisdom. And as we know from the miners, that is what we too are gifted to do. By the way, you might not know Job 28 off by heart, but all County Durham miners do. It's called the Miner's Prayer, because it's the place in the Bible where miners are talked about, and talked about rather favourably. And if you go to County Durham and visit us, I do recommend you visit Easington Colliery Parish Church, and you will find the Miner's Prayer on a stained glass window on the northwest side. It's quite lovely. There's a bit of a personal northeastern bit to it. Now, can you see how the Lord's answer is now perhaps not so inappropriate? Because when your question is, oh God, you're out of control, the world is as unjust as it is chaotic, perhaps a right interesting question to ask is, come with me to the foundations of the earth. Have you ever tried to create a world? Let's see how you would do it. I was talking with Dr. Chris Southgate earlier this evening, weren't we, who's here, and was telling us with some delight that at one point in his theology course he asks his students, who might well be complaining about the injustice of the world, to create one. Your God for the afternoon. Make a universe and tell me about it. And I do feel that this is what God is doing in Job. After all, Hebrew questions are never a put-down. They're also always educational. There are 3,600 and something questions in the Bible. The first one is, where are you? Did God ask Adam where he was because God didn't know? No, he asked Adam where he was because he wanted Adam to think. God wants us to think about our relationship with the natural world. And he wants to give us a new narrative. Now, if you want to find out a bit more about this, now is perhaps not the time to go into any deeper into the analysis, I really shouldn't, but if you really want to, cheap on Amazon, you will find that in the book of Job there are these different narratives of how we relate to nature. There's those five narratives who've always been with us, the despairing ones. One of them is Job's despairing one. Nature is just chaotic. There's another one, nature is sacred. Yahweh accuses Job of worshipping nature. There's another one of be careful for what you wish for. This is Elihu's narrative. They're all there. They've always been with us, those deep despairing. But thanks to the wisdom of the book of Job, we are introduced to a sixth way, which is the way of wisdom, which is the way of looking into nature as creators, as created in the image of God, but also creators of an understanding of nature, so that we can have the relationship with it that echoes and responds to that first command in the garden, to go to the world and subdue it, not in a domineering way, but in a husbandry, making fruitful sort of way. Mend a relationship with nature. Ah, that's interesting. Because just to finish with, of course, we ought to just spend two ticks just calibrating where we are through a New Testament lens, shouldn't we? Because when you do biblical theology, the Old Testament has the raw material, right? And the New Testament is the lens, or the cross and the resurrection is the lens with which we look at the new material. So if we're talking about mending a relationship with nature that's been broken, a relationship in which we were meant to have deep knowledge and deal with nature with wisdom and in mutual fruitfulness, but we didn't. We were in ignorance of it. And because we're ignorant of nature, we are afraid of it. And because we are afraid of it, it hurts us and we hurt it. Have you ever thought about it? It's the hallmark of any broken relationship. Broken friendships, broken marriages, broken villages, broken races. You can bet your life, can't you, that if you've got a broken relationship, it starts off with ignorance. You're disagreeing, you're hurting because you don't really know each other. Yeah? And so what you've got to do is to, and because you don't know each other, there's a lot of fear there because you don't know what the other one will do. They don't know you, they're going to hurt you. And then you do hurt each other. So that's exactly where we are with nature. We're starting with ignorance and we need to move from ignorance to knowledge. That's what science does. But not leaving us at knowledge, but going on to wisdom and then fruitful mutual relationship. That's what healing involves. Now, just go with me to St. Paul. Once you've attuned your ear to the telling, the biblical telling and retelling of creation stories, to remind us of the deep plot, whenever we're not sure where we're going, think of Romans 8 first, which begins, finally, there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, and wants to get to, nothing will therefore separate us from the love of God, not flood, not illness, not death, not anything. How does Paul get to the promise from the hope? All creation groans until the children of God are revealed. He tells this creation, this groaning creation story, as the whole creation, the cosmos, when we're in childbirth. Let's go to the Corinthian correspondence, when Paul is on the back foot and needs to say in one sound bite what Christianity is. And do you remember what he says? One simple, beautiful sentence. We have the ministry of reconciliation. That's how he puts it. I think it's brilliant. If he were today, he'd be the master of the soundbite. Let's go to today program. Okay, Paul, we've only got 5 minutes before the 9 o'clock news. Some people say you're atheists. Some people say you're perverted Jews. Some people say you're political destabilizers. What are you? And Paul gets the microphone for 5 minutes and he thinks, well, shall I tell this man and our listeners about Jesus of Nazareth? No, I can't do that because they don't know anything about Jesus of Nazareth. Well, it was the same in AD 55. No one had really heard. They needed to hear the stories. Should I talk about Abraham and Moses? No, because I've got all sorts of listeners. I know what I'll say. I'll say, John, so it's about the healing of broken relationships. That's what we do. That's our job. It's brilliant. And because that's what God does for us, that's what we now do. So think about science in that little framework. If some of us are called in our priestly calling to heal families, or as doctors to heal bodies, or as politicians at any stage to heal communities, or as heads of families to heal and make families flourish, it's all about mending relationships. Maybe scientists are given the very humblest of healing jobs of all, which is to heal this relationship, not between humans and other humans, but between humans and this material world. Perhaps that's what we're here for. So if science is the participative, relational, and co-creative work within the kingdom of God of healing our fallen relationship of humans with nature, maybe we've found what we call a purpose. And if we've got that purpose, can you see how it changes all the debates and all the fractured arguments that I started with? Can you think how it would make different a discussion, a public discussion about new technologies? Can you see how it would make different the way the church might engage with science? Can you see how it might even introduce a therapeutic way for some people to become reconciled to the world? Can you see what it might do under political debates, what it might do to the healing of this dreadful division which we call the two cultures? One of the most cruel questions I think you can ever ask of a child is she on the art side or the science side? Yeah? Throw that one out. You see what it might do for interfaith dialogue. because all of our faiths are wrestling this question, how much better it is to work on a common challenge than to discuss our differences all the time. Can you see how it might enrich our tawdry and thin media framing of science that deprives us of so much? And can you see how it might enrich our churches? But I don't need to tell you that, because you're already here and I'm preaching to the converted. But perhaps we can go together in question time in a little minute or two and ask what we can now do. And as God says to Job, get up your loins and answer me. Perhaps we can get up together and gird up our loins and think what we might go on and do, having taken this journey to Job's mountaintop and seen a vision of science as ancient wisdom before us, where we might go in obedience after this and change the world. So thank you very much indeed.